Shouldn't you be on a call praying for me with my other apostles? Wanda Williams, good to see you. Queens, New York. I do come to Southern California. Looking forward to the subject. Interesting. Well, it's not really a subject. I'm going to be engaging with those that follow me on Periscope and giving wisdom and insight and counsel. It is so, so important. All right. So let me start with giving you a few scriptures that are very, very important for why the right advice is important, and why the Bible talks about the importance of counsel, and why the Bible admonishes us to seek counsel, and to understand counsel, and to understand what the Lord accomplishes by counsel. Okay, so if you are ready, before I start allowing you to ask your questions, let me know you're ready by sending me a thumb. Go ahead and share your share this with your Pastor Mary, please share this with your networks, and give me thumbs. Let me know you're ready. I got my water. Okay, awesome. All right. Scripture number one. Let's get these numbers up there, guys. Scripture number one is Proverbs 11 and 14. Proverbs 11 and 14. It reads like this in the King James Bible. Where there is no counsel, the people fall. But in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. Where there is no counsel, the people fall. But in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. That's Proverbs 11 and 14. The New American Standard Bible reads this. Where there is no guidance, the people fall, but in the abundance of counselors, there is victory. Where there is no guidance, the people fall, but in the abundance of counselors, there is victory. The same scripture in the New Living Translation says, without wise leadership, a nation falls. There is safety in having many advisors. So that is important. So we already see that there is an emphasis actually all throughout the book of Proverbs about why counsel is important, why insight and right advice is important to those of you that are accomplishing and achieving things. And so that is very important. And the next verse I'm going to give you is Proverbs 15 and 22. Proverbs 15 and 22. Everybody there? Let me know. Okay, Proverbs 15, 22 says this. I'll give you the King James Version too. The King James Version says, without counsel, purposes are disappointed, but in the multitude of counsel, they are established. It says, without counsel, purposes are disappointed, but in the multitude of counselors, they are established. So this is a very important principle that is all throughout the book of Proverbs, is the importance of the ministry of counsel, of advice, of insight, because, you know, the quality of your decision making is often a direct in direct relationship to the quality of your advisors and the quality of the advice you follow. It's important that if you're going to make good quality decisions, that you've got to be informed. You've got to have things bounced off of people that know what they're talking about, but most importantly, can apply the principles of the word to your particular scenario. I'm going to give you another one. Proverbs 24 and 6. Proverbs 24 and 6. These are all verses that I want you to know as we are preparing to end and close this year out and go into a year of new things and new ventures and new relationships and new focuses and new mentalities, new opportunities, new disciplines. These are very important principles that you need to be aware of. Proverbs 24 and 6 says in the King James Bible, for by wise counsel thou shalt make thy war, and in the multitude of counselors there is safety. It says, for by wise counsel thou shalt make thy war. war, and in the multitude of counselors there is safety. So there is this consistent theme from the last three scriptures I've given you about safety, where that there is an element of God's insurance purpose and insurance plan for all that you are, all that you have, all that you house, all that you mean to the kingdom, that God is interested in your safety. And one of the safety measures of God is the right counsel, the right insight, the right wisdom, the right advisors. That is very important. Now, I'm not telling you to go around indiscriminately talking to everybody about the things that are important to you and divulging the measures and the meditations of your heart to people that are not capacitated to handle it, but you ought to have somebody. Shouldn't be everybody, but you ought to have somebody. My final verse is going to be Proverbs 20 and 18. Proverbs 20 and 18. God is concerned with your safety, and there is a direct relationship between the wars you're going to face and the counselor that's in your corner. The war and the effectiveness of your war, the sagaciousness of your war, the level of accuracy of your aim in war is going to very often be determined by the quality of your counsel. There's a lot of people ensnared and entrapped because of the lack of counsel or because of adhering to the wrong counsel. So counsel is an important biblical concept. Proverbs 20 and 18. Proverbs 20 and 18. And we're going to do some work. Proverbs 20 and 18 says this in the King James Bible. Every purpose is established by counsel, and by good advice make your war. Again, it says every purpose is established by counsel, and by good advice make your war. I'm going to read this in the New Living Translation to give you this insight again. Plans succeed through good counsel. Don't go to war without wise advice. There is a lot of people who have just reduced the book of Proverbs to being a book that's just about wisdom, kind of like fortune cookie level, proverbial things to live by. But I believe that the subject of war and engagement probably screams a little louder as the reason for the wisdom. It's not just about life and the quality of life. It's about life for those of us that have an adversary, that have an opponent, that have things that you have to live by and principles that guard your life and your decision making. And the Bible calls it a war. So those of us that have resolved that our life, our destiny, our purpose will mandate some level of conflict, be it with the powers of darkness, with the powers of our culture, or sometimes even with things around or in us, war is inevitable. And so I've just given you four scriptures that substantiate why we need counsel and inspired speakers in our lives and inspired speakers in our circle to help us to be better at the war we were born for. That is absolutely appropriate. If you agree with that, I want you to respond by saying, I need counsel. C-O-U-N-S-E-L. C-O-U-N-S-E-L. I need counsel. Thank you, baby bishop. You're so precious to me. Thank you, Geronimo. Thank you, Elder Moore. Thank you, Emery Diggs. Thank you, Sean John. Awesome. 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 So we all agree. We have already proven that the Bible establishes your need for right counsel, right advice, right insight, right interpretation, right processing, right language, right direction. So that's very, very, very important. All right. So I'm excited to spend this time with you, speaking into some of your wars, speaking into some of your plans. And I want you to be courageous because maybe some of the questions you'll ask me may be applicable to a lot of people. Baby, you're not allowed on here. I want you to get off. You don't need counsel. You have me. may bless somebody that's watching this. So a lot of you may ask a question that somebody else may be able to extract a level of wisdom from. So don't be afraid about asking your questions, because it may help and it may bless somebody else. All right. So please be patient. If you write a whole paragraph and I can't see it, then just retap until I get to you. These questions are going to go very fast. And we're going to begin now with Ricky Watson Jr. How do you posture yourself to be mentored? That is a great question. But I want to say that you've got to, number one, make your decision on what you believe a mentor is and what you believe that mentor's responsibility is to be to you, because your definition is going to determine your expectation. Now, as far as posture is concerned, I think that there is a way to put priority on the information that a person has to offer you that gives them priority in your life. Now, I am somebody who believes that you can have multiple mentors, I guess, as long as it's not conflictual, depending upon the area of your life the person is pouring into. But I always say that the pour is never up, it's always down. The greatest way to activate the insight that is in somebody that you're learning from is to display how teachable you are. Once you value the level of insight and information that a person has and you make it known that that's the case, then it'll begin to flow from you. Now, another thing that you need to know about posturing yourself under a mentor is that you've got to make sure that you are built to handle the mentoring style of your particular mentor, because mentoring is very vast and a lot of people do it a lot of different ways, and you can be mentored in certain skill sets, you can be mentored in certain projects. So it just depends on the type of mentor you're pursuing and whether or not that person is going to be suited to handle you the right way. But posture is important. And as far as posture is concerned, this discussion that I'm giving you is probably more appropriate for spiritual fathering, but I'm going to just still tell you to still study the example of Elisha and Elijah with the principle of pursuit. There is a principle of pursuit that will turn the focus of a mentor towards you, and as long as it doesn't violate principles of spiritual authority, I'm certain that most people would not be against teaching you something that you need to succeed and to fare well. So you need to specify the area you like to be mentored in. Number one, you need to make sure that it's God. Number two, you need to specify that they are compatible for what God is calling you into, and make sure that you communicate freely and truly and transparently about where you are, because without an accurate assessment of where you are, a mentor cannot help you interpret where you need to go, whether it's in your career, in your marriage, and whatever you need. So those are some principles of posture. I don't think anybody has got it better than maybe John the Beloved and Elisha the prophet. So those are some principles I would give you for that. All right. Next question. How do you approach a person you are assigned to mentor? You don't necessarily approach a person that you are assigned to mentor unless that person has been made aware that that's what they want you to be. I am very cautious about bombarding into people's lives, and so there have been times where I knew that I would pour into a leader, or that I would be a part of a leader's story, or there have even been times that I've known years in advance that somebody would be like a son in the Lord to me, and I wouldn't say a word. I'm not going to be the one to initiate that discussion, because if I'm the one to initiate that discussion and to start that process without the agreement or the involvement or the awareness of the opposite party, then when I say or do something that they disagree with, then they have the right to scream, "Control, control." So what I do is I allow for that person, I have conversations, we interact freely up until that person comes to the point of consistency where definition is needful. And then I push that person to God to see what they believe that I am, and either I agree or I don't. But I define the relationship before I fully immerse myself into it so that the parameters of that are established. But even if I know I'm not going to do it, or be the one to do it. Now, you may select a person to disciple, and you may walk up on a person and say, "I'd like to help you," but I think it's a little premature to call it an official mentorship until there is an agreement on both parties that is what they're going to commit to, and that's what they're going to be willing to be held accountable to. Is it okay to ask your mentor to mentor you, or should you wait on them? Well, I think it is not a bad discussion to have. I just think that you've got to be suited to handle the responses and the answers and be willing to readjust or readapt if it's a timing issue, if it's an authority issue, or if it's an issue of the lack of accountability. So I just think you need to brace yourself for that. Next question. Is it appropriately to specifically request a person for counseling? I would have to know a little bit more about what you mean. Yes, how do you break soul ties? That's a great question. The way you break soul ties is to, number one, remove yourself from the person, the environment, the situation that fuels or strengthens the soul tie. You have got to back up and you've got to distance yourself from the relationship or from the involvement, and then you've got to deal with the spirits or the spiritual effects of the soul tie on your life, in your soul. And obviously, I don't believe that a person can effectively break a soul tie without being in a deliverance or spiritual warfare environment, because I believe that that fusing, that cohesiveness that happens as a byproduct of you engaging in something that leads to a soul tie, that does not only just happen by sex. Soul ties are built by intimacy, not just sex. But when a soul tie is formed, it's important that you establish boundaries and parameters from a person, cut the tie, and reorientate yourself from how you built yourself psychologically and soulishly to accommodate the presence of that person in your life. You've got to put boundaries, ignore, cut them out all the way. It's very, very, very important that you do that. All right, next question. What if it's your mate? Well, if it's your mate, you don't want to not have a soul tie with your mate. The Bible says the two shall become one. What are your thoughts on economic empowerment in the black church? Well, my thoughts on economic empowerment in the church, period, is that it is largely absent for the most part. If by the black church you mean the inner city expression of the church, I don't necessarily know that I know a lot of African American churches are financially astute. Many of them don't touch the issue of finances except on or around tithes and offerings. So I think the biggest problem with financial empowerment is that it's more of a literacy and an ignorance issue. I don't think that I have seen a lot of people besides those that are in the Word of Faith expression that deal with it. And so because of it, you have a lot of financial abuses and a lot of ideas about financial issues. So I think the bigger issue is literacy and being learned. A person cannot be good at finances if they are afraid to learn money and what got them there. Okay, next. Signs and symptoms of a schizophrenic ministry. Can you tell me what you mean by a schizophrenic ministry? Would I advocate for it? 100%. I am a friend of money. Absolutely. How do I get clarity on a church horn, or can God call you to many? Well, clarity on a church horn, when you're evaluating whether or not the right church is compatible for you, you have to look at the oil on the house, the message of the leader, whether or not you can find yourself delivered and restored, but most importantly, dressed for your future in that house. And if you cannot clarify why you are in a house, I would go back to God about whether or not it was him that put you in there or if you went there for convenience. God has a way of assigning people to a leader and a leader to a people. And so I would go back and look at the content of a house to see whether or not it's where I'm supposed to be, or if I'm there to be, or if I'm just there for romantic or sentimental reasons or clarifications. Okay, that was a great question about marriage, but I missed it. Do you think leaders of the church should disclose the financial info to the church? Well, it depends on what financial info it is. I think if it's project-based, I'm not against it. I believe that there are certain measures of financial transparency that should be disclosed. But I think that there are other accountability measures like boards, business protocols. I think that when you're dealing with a project, however, it is wise to let the church know where you stand on saving for things so that there is a goal that can be invested in and that people have no reason to accuse a leader or the head of a ministry of not appropriating finances appropriately. How do I know who's right, who to turn to? Who do I know when it's okay to trust again? Okay, are you talking about romantically in a ministry situation? Be specific about what you mean. Many times the Lord wants to mentor us himself. Take Israel and how they wanted a king and counsel. I don't know if that's a question or not. How do you know if you're called to the prophetic? If you're saved, I don't believe that there is a believer in the world that is not called to the prophetic. Now, if you're talking about in a different degree or to different realms of it, then that would be important. How do you approach a prideful family member that is a pastor and needs counsel? You be transparent with them about what you believe, and you advise them in love about what you feel like their pride is affecting as far as their potential is a world. Do you support Pastor Jamal Bryant's Kwanzaa Mall? I don't know much about it, but Pastor Jamal Bryant is a personal friend of mine, so I frankly support whatever he feels like God has called him to do. Can all of us practice spiritual warfare? Absolutely. Your God is a warrior. So if he's in you, then you have war in and around you, whether you are aware of it or not. Does husband and wife need to attend the same church? I believe that it is spiritually beneficial for a husband and wife to attend the same church, but I'm not going to make it a dogma because I don't understand the nuances of that particular relationship. The challenge of a husband and wife being in different churches is they are exposed to different teachings, and those teachings are responsible for shaping the value systems of the homes that they lead. So with two different people, one the head and one the help, receiving two different qualities of information, it may be difficult to advance in the house if the husband who is the head and the wife who is the help cannot come to terms with the quality of teaching and under the same authority. So it could get really, really, really strange in that particular instance. I suppose it's worked with some people. I've not seen it be very successful for long term. How do you cope with your wife that doesn't have faith like yours? You grow it in her. As a husband, one of the things that you have the ability to do is cultivate your wife, and you have the ability to invest in her and to allow for opportunities through love for her to become her best self. I would start to harvest by seeds and start to allow her opportunity to be taught by you and your example, and they will respond normally accordingly. Okay, next. How do I find out what my purpose and identity is? Great question. I would start by examining the things about the world around you that grieve you, the things that you hate, the things that you love, what makes you cry, what makes you restless, what do you find yourself wanting to do all the time, what's important to you, what are the subjects that you ramble about, what things are close to your nerves. Those are some signs and symptoms of that. Faith 1:11, I think you're the only person that's froze. You have received accurate words in the past, now desire counseling. Approach them. Certainly, I mean, the most that can happen is that they can tell you yay or nay and be prepared for that, for the discussion, but don't do it. No, it's not a marriage scope, Mom, it's a Q&A. Holy Spirit versus counsel, what are your thoughts about a season of isolation? I don't know that a season of isolation is a New Testament principle, and I don't know that it's completely biblical. Most people that I have seen go through the season of isolation deal with a strong spirit of pride. I believe that God has called us to community, and that's not to say that every day you have, you need to spend around people. I believe your primary objective should be to be disciplined in your devotion, but I don't believe that the Lord has ever called anybody to be isolated. He doesn't call you to be a part of the body to extract you. Is it okay to attend many churches? I mean, as far as being a member, I'm not exactly sure what you mean by that. If I'm called to a ministry, how do I get further training? You involve yourself in an environment that is capable of training you. Pertaining to the call of God, discuss the difference between a mantle, anointing, grace, influence. Well, if there is a mantle on your life that is specific to a position, if there is a grace on your life, then it means that it is specific to an ability. If there is influence, then that means that there is something about authority. So they all function in different ways. There are people who have, in the Bible, mantles were used to describe, and mantles were used to clarify to a public that a person occupied a specific position. To us contemporarily, I believe mantles are spiritual, and what they do is they simplify symbolize, thank you. I don't know where my mind went. They symbolize our resources, our capabilities, and our position in the spirit to the invisible world. So mantles are for positions. Grace means that I have an ability. An anointing means that something comes up on me to achieve a specific purpose at a specific time. May or may not be dormant. It may be that God given you an unction to achieve a function for a reason at that particular time. How does one grow more confident as a teacher? Great question. If you are a teacher, one of the most powerful ways you could do is diversify your knowledge base by expanding your ability to retain information and seek for hidden things in the scriptures. What I'm finding is that a lot of teachers feel like their only strength is to be practical and pragmatic, and we do need a place for the practical. But there is also a place where we need to have those that can make simple the difficult. That means to reach into some of the more complex issues of scripture and interpret them in ways, perhaps parables or different teaching styles. So I would say master your craft, learn diverse ways to communicate to diverse audiences, and make sure that your grasp and your reach into the scripture is never stagnated by you becoming content with the types of principles you've seen. Great question. I have, however, she's manipulative and many times against my husband. I miss that. Should prophets marry prophets? I think prophets can marry who they want to marry. How do you help someone get delivered from witchcraft and occult ministry if they're not aware? If a person is not aware that they are in a witchcraft and an occult ministry, the only thing you can do is confront them with the truth and the principles of the Word of God and hope that through the power of that confrontational word from the Bible that substantiated that somebody is able to break through the blindness of it, because that's one of the things that witchcraft does, is it blinds and can help them to come out of denial, to make them make some decisions about what they need to do. Do pets go to heaven? What are your thoughts? I don't know that Jesus died to save the souls of pets, so I can't necessarily say that in my Bible experience that I've ever had biblical proof that dogs and cats were in heaven. So I'm going to say I plead the fifth. Went to minister for wise counsel, didn't agree with what she told me about my relationship. Well, you probably shouldn't have gone for wise counsel. If you're not going to allow the advice that you get to be considered with you, there's either two things wrong. Either you were not really going for counsel, you were going for agreement, or you chose the wrong person to go to. Importance of empowering youth in church. I think empowering youth in church is of utmost importance. A church that refuses to adequately resource their youth is automatically canceling their future. It is our obligation. God always introduced himself in the Old Testament as the God of at least three generations. I am the God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob. So I believe that we need to think in terms of our generational strategies to make sure that our life, our churches have a life beyond the life or longer than the life of its initial founder. That's very important. A church with a poor youth ministry has no future. What's the most challenging part of pastoring? Loving people. What's a healthy way to deal with a cross-generational ministry, young adults and elders? Well, number one, if you're going to deal with a cross-generational ministry, you've got to have leadership representation of every generation. Most people who are trying to bridge the gap with generations in their church have misappropriated revelation or misappropriated leadership representation. You can't have all old leaders or you can't have all young leaders. If you have a multi-generational or even if you want a multi-ethnic church, you've got to do your best to have several degrees of generational representation in leadership. So if they see it in leadership, they'll be attracted to the church. So you've got to have a broad variance of leaders there. How should one deliver a strong word of rebuke to a world-renowned leader? Well, it depends on who you are and what your realm of authority is. I doubt very seriously that God would give a strong word of rebuke to a prophetic vessel who does not have a national platform. It's a violation of the laws of authority in the Bible. Wherever rebuke was given from a prophet to a leader, it was because they had the same level of national influence. Somebody who is more local or inexperienced probably won't be mature enough to handling insight from God about a leader who has a national platform of influence from a prophetic vessel who does not. What type of prayers should we be praying for our children to intercede for their salvation? Good question. I say we pray the prayers of Jesus, that they would not be led out of the world, but that they would be protected by the evil one. There's a powerful principle called the prayer of one sent that's taught by Bishop Joseph Matera that talks about the only prayer that Jesus prayed, that the book of Luke gives us insight into Jesus's prayer life and what he said. I would say pray that God would make them one with him and in their purpose and unify them, that they would be delivered from the wicked one, but they would also be crafted for their destiny. What I'm learning about children is that we invest too little in their destiny. We are very interested in their hobbies and their habits and their friends, and all of those things are really, really good, but most potently, we probably need to be worried about why they're here to begin with, and then we need to begin to invest in that accordingly. Come on, guys. These are good questions. Keep the hearts coming. What's next? Is everyone a child of God? No. Do you have a ministry in Jacksonville, Florida? No. What if you see someone lacking? I can get that. Oh, goodness. Okay, this is going really fast. How far is too far? Is there such a thing as too far in leadership transparency? What do you mean by that? Give me some clarity on that. How to raise and protect a child with such a great mantle, and how not to become intimidated, fearful. Well, when you start to notice that your child is showing signs of being gifted or have some type of leadership call, the most important thing you could do is give them outlets to express the thing that is growing in them. One of the most frustrating things you could do with a gifted child is not allow them for the outlets of expression. And then when you do that, you start allowing for different sources to start to counsel them and start to alienate them because they can't cope with their difference. Every child that is a born leader, no matter what they're supposed to do, and some of us literally are born that way, they need outlets and opportunities to develop it. Without the appropriate outlets, they're going to become isolated, alienated, their relationships will be dysfunctional, they're not going to know how to engage with other people, and then they'll end up needing deliverance or probably be coming to the well. Make sure they have outlets of expression. They also need to be challenged. You need to, can a young child speak with tongue? Yes, there is no such thing as a junior Holy Spirit. So they need outlets. They need opportunities. They need challenging information that can make them grow into the thing that's growing in them. That's very, very, very important. Call to change a worship team from always, and as a result, they all leave. Help. I would need a little bit more information to deal with that. How do you deal with an unfaithful husband, pastor? Wow. Well, the way you deal with an unfaithful husband is up to you. Generally speaking, I have, you do have scriptural backing for dismissing yourself from a marriage where a husband has been unfaithful. Do I think that that needs to be automatic or mandatory? I'm going to be very candid. I think it depends on how strong you are. Depending upon what you know you can handle and the level of work you're ready to put into restoration, you could stay, and sometimes that affair could be the greatest thing that has ever happened to you. I've seen couples recuperate and recover from an affair after years of counseling and restoration that actually brought them closer and addressed certain breaches in that marital scenario that was the reason behind the affair to begin with. But the reverse is also true. I have also seen where it took more work to forgive than it did to just release it. So it really just depends on the type of wife you are and where you are in your heart. But most importantly, the type of support you have to cultivate you for the mental and the soul war that you are listing up. Here's the deal. If you let him go and divorce him, you're going to have a war. If you keep him, you're going to have a war. So my greatest counsel to you would be to make sure that you don't escalate or you don't fast forward through a counseling process and make sure that you have space to process what you want to do. And often a separation should be wise so that you don't have the immediate proximity challenges of interpreting what you have to deal with if there are children involved and imagining what life could be with or without that spouse. Is it possible to be healed from an affair? Absolutely, but it just depends on what you're dealing with. What is your suggestion on helping your spouse get delivered from porn? Professional counseling and a deliverance ministry. There needs to be accountability. He needs to have boundaries around how much freedom he has. He needs to have accountability that's separate from his wife. When you have a demon of addiction, particularly to pornography, it is not an issue of a sexual appetite. When a person has a demon of lust, all the sex in the world is not going to satisfy that appetite. It is a bottomless pit, and it is incapable of being fed. So that person needs professional counseling and also the devil cast out. How to handle a mate that won't leave and cleave. I don't know what you mean. Give me some more information. Please expound on everyone not being a child of God. The Bible says, to as many as believed on him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God. So if everybody does not believe him, we are all his creation, but we are not all his children. How can prophets learn to be more tactful and not so brash? Well, I believe that they need to be vetted by more mature prophets, if in fact a prophet is what that person is. I don't know that all prophets are brash. I know that they tend to be matter of fact because of their ability to quickly decipher the root of an issue or the truth of the principle behind an action. But I don't know that I would say that all prophets are brash. I just think that some of them have not learned how to pull back some of their personality from their presentation of the truth of what they have to say. And so I think that the key to that would be mentorship. What season do you think the church should be in? Some say occupation within the seven mountains. Well, my problem is the church is not expanding. So I don't know that I would say that that's a specific season. I would say that we should be very occupied with our growth challenges, to be very frank, because I'm not convinced that a church that is not healthily and steadfastly growing with New Testament momentum is going to be able to find penetration in the seven mountains to begin with. So I think in order to call yourself invading a certain sphere, you need to have the manpower to do so. And most churches that are preaching the seven mountain doctrine, which I strongly believe in, are not healthy enough to engage the certain principalities that are seated on top of each of those spheres. I think they need to worry about becoming an army and a mega force before they invade into those spheres. What to do when no church growth because people want to stay in the old? You decide and ask God if that's where you need to be. What are your thoughts on what happened in Paris? I have a lot of thoughts about what happened in Paris. Prophetically, the subject of terrorism is something that I'm almost monthly seeking God about. And so I think that what we saw in Paris is going to be a catalytic event that is going to lead into some other things that we need to be extremely prayerful about. Question, does the number four mean anything? I keep seeing the number four. I would study biblical numerology. Four is normally the number of the earth. You got the four winds of the earth, the north, south, east, the west. Four is generally the number of the earth. How to approach a pastor defaming your ministry because their former members have joined. Well, you decide whether or not that's a battle you want to fight. I have always said, Bishop J.D. Brown, I want you to take my words on this. In my city, that is a very common thing for me. I think that there is this preacher code somewhere that if somebody decides to leave their church, that you as the pastor have the obligation to have the conversation with that pastor about whether or not that person should have left. But here is my opinion on this. My opinion on this is that if a sheep decides to leave you as a shepherd, that is between you and that particular sheep. I seldom involve myself in the decision of somebody to leave another church to join mine unless they tore that house up on their way out or they were a position leader and did not give their leader the absolute notice to know that they were going. But my opinion is I think people have the right to go to whatever church they feel like they're led to go to. I don't control people's church direction. Now, when you deal with pastors that get upset with you because their members are joining, you tell them you don't steal sheep, you grow grass, and make no apology for preaching or building a church that is capacitated to meet the needs of hungry people. And when hungry people come, they come and can't fit back out the door to fit these other frail houses. Let them preachers go get counseling, then they'll be fine. How do you deal with the spirit of fear? Well, the Bible says that perfect love casts out all fear. You've got to learn to mature yourself in love, and you've got to see how love has been affected in you and over you before you come out of agreement with the spirit of fear. That's very important for you. Baby, please don't say boom. When are you going to do part two on manipulation and control from church leaders? Very soon. No, I don't steal sheep. I grow grass, and I don't apologize for growing very healthy grass. If the sheep come, they come. I didn't do it. They did. How do you deal with religious discrimination? What do you mean by that? How do you cope with the grief of lost loved ones? Awesome question. Well, grief is a beast. Let me just say that. And I think in the body of Christ, we know too little about the subject of grief. And whenever you're dealing with any type of death, there's going to be a grieving process. I have had a really interesting life. And but I tell people all the time, the worst thing that has ever happened to me was the sudden murder of my father. I had never felt a pain like that in my entire life. And I have had some painful things happen to me. But my dad's death was the worst. Now, when I went through that, I had never really had something like that happen to me. So I didn't really know what to expect grief to do or how to respond or act to it, nor did I know when it showed up. But when it showed up, without exaggeration, it took about 2 years to leave because I didn't know how to handle it. I didn't know what to do. So I think the biggest thing that you can do to help somebody in grief is to be supportive and consistent with them and allow them the right to express themselves. Grief is something so important because it goes from anger to confusion, to exhaustion, to depression. So grief has a major spectrum. I've seen people grieve from abortion. I have seen people grieve from divorce. It's like a literal death. And so you've got to really process that, but grieving people really do need a strong support system that can make them talk through their thoughts and feelings and not be judged for where they are, but redirected to the hope that is in Christ Jesus. Ulysses Ruff, I love you so much, sir. I have dreams and visions that manifest almost exactly the way I see them. What does that mean? Well, it could mean that you are a seer, or it could mean that you are a dreamer of dreams. There are people who have a ministry. The book of Deuteronomy talks about a dreamer of dreams, and I believe that that is an entire ministry where God uses some people to forecast and know things by the virtue of dreams. And I also do believe that it is a sign and a feature of the ministry of intercession. I have yet to see somebody who was a dreamer of dreams and didn't have an intercessory responsibility. So I would study the role of an intercessor. The Watchman by Joe Eboji is a great book that will help you understand why you dream and what to do with them. What do you think the ethnic church don't focus on healthy eating and fitness? Ah, great question. Well, primarily because I think that food is how we cope with life. And I really do believe that we've not had teaching or biblical understanding about why God wants us healthy. And so I just, you know, in the urban church, the pulpit has more power than what we are willing to admit. And I think that the major reason why people are not embracing a call to health and healthiness is because it has very little representation in the pulpit. If the pulpits of America would start to hammer the subject of health and healthiness like they do get rich quick or preaching about haters, then ultimately after a year or so, it would start to circulate. I think it's the lack of representation from preachers. Who's next? What are your thoughts about when people say that African Americans are the true Hebrew Israelites? I think that they need professional help. How long does it take for someone to heal from a domestic violence relationship? It depends on that person, and it depends on the depth of that relationship and who's interpreting them with that particular process. What do you do when God is elevating you, but your spouse won't let you serve in the church? Whoa, I would have to really evaluate whether or not you were honestly equally yoked. How do you balance focusing on your God-given grace with being balanced and well-rounded? Give me some more information for that, and I'll help it. Give me some more detail, and I'll give you. Can we break generational curses off a living generation who are in denial and unreceptive? Well, that's the challenge with trying to break a curse off of somebody that is cursed, and in agreement with it is going to be difficult. Because what gives anybody the authority over a curse is their unwillingness to remain in it. Their unwillingness to remain in it comes by the awareness that it has existed. People cooperate with curses by being willing to live in the effects of them and the stuff that the curses provide. So I would say it was a very daunting task to do, but the power of fasting and prayer, your focus may become primarily intercessory in nature, where that you pray that God begins to weaken the stronghold of that curse until that person is ready to respond to the opportunity to be delivered and come out of agreement with how that curse has formulated them and groomed them to be. All right. Please explain to me what it means when you have dreams you're conversing with Satan. Give me more details with that. What kind of boundaries, opportunities do you give prophets in your church? Great question. Well, when I notice that there may be, number one, that there may be a budding prophet in our midst, the number one thing that I do is give them prayer responsibility. I never give an emerging prophet or somebody that I am suspicious is an emerging prophet a microphone, because there are times where I need to decipher if this is a prophet, if this is a prophesier, or if this is a seer, or if this is a psalmist, or if this is an intercessor. Sometimes they can all look alike, but be different. But immediately when I sense that somebody might be called to be a prophet or a prophetess, I expose them and I mandate them to the ministry of prayer in our local church. Then, after I grow more and more convinced that this person may show signs and symptoms of being called to the office of the prophet, I expose them to an environment. In our church, we have two. We have an environment called a prophetic discipleship group. These are for people. Some of them are prophets. Some of them are just strongly prophetic, but they are more prophetic than most. And this is a class or an accountability group that we formed to help them understand what life is going to be like for them as a prophetic person. They don't talk about prophecy. They don't talk about prophesying. They don't talk about any of that. They talk about how being a prophetic person affects your personality, your relationships, the way you see life, how it affects your tests, the depths of them, the durations of them. So that is the group that I allow. Depending upon how those people do in that group, I sift them on to a different training for people that I believe are called to the office of the prophet. And that's where I come in and I begin to teach them office responsibility, which are the features, the tasks, the scripturally outlined duties of that office and the personality. But I seldom release people in that without seeing how they handle responsibility in prayer and how they can handle being trained to handle life as a prophetic person. Because whether or not we're willing to realize it or not, prophetic people are going to live different lives. It's just the way they live is going to be different. Now, that doesn't alienate them from the rest of the world. I think every gift has a different life that they're going to live. But life as a prophetic person is going to be a lot more different from life as a normal person, for the lack of a better way to say it. And so because of that, we allow those outlets. Now, when they are faithful in a team environment, then I allow them to prophesy in certain environments. I'll give them opportunities to share the word of the Lord. I'll give them the opportunity to be engaged in different prophetic environments led by some of our more mature prophets. And that's how we do it with that. What will be the sign of your coming? Of my coming? I'm not Jesus. Describe the militaristic mindset that you have. What do you mean? Be more specific. What do you say about churches that don't allow the prophetic or to move in? I say they need to come and become a real church. How do you get clarity on prophetic dreams? You've got to master types and symbols. How do you feel about prophets asking for donations on Periscope and a free app? It depends on how they're doing it, whether or not it's tactful and whether or not it's biblically inclined and what they're doing it for. I am not against prophets raising offerings. I believe that the prophetic office is directly connected to economy, so I know that it needs to happen. Believe on the Lord your God, you will be established, and believe his prophets and you will prosper. But I'm assuming the ones that you've seen have done very distastefully when they do it. What do you do when it seems that your comprehension level is low? You begin to write and you begin to journal and you begin to discipline your intake of other things. Generally, when a person's comprehension level is too low, it's because what they're trying to comprehend is in conflict with the other stuff that they've made priority with. Word of knowledge and prophecy, how are they related? Well, the word of knowledge is a supernaturally revealed fact that was not naturally known by a person, whereas prophecy is a sentence, a statement from God. Some prophecies contain a word of knowledge. The reverse is not necessarily true. Should a pastor and apostle have an overseer? Every last one of them. The only time a pastor or an apostle should not have a human overseer is if they are without a soul. If they don't have a soul, then they don't need a shepherd. But if they got a soul, they need a shepherd too. Can you have different spiritual gifts in different seasons of ministry? Well, you can have certain things that operate in you stronger at certain seasons, but if you have a spiritual gift, it probably is active in you or dormant in you. And the season does change, however, what you flow in. It doesn't necessarily dictate what gifts you have. It just means that for whatever reason, the season has mandated your use of some and not the others. You know where to. I'm trying to be direct. Nice diversion. I don't understand what you mean. I've had moments when I predict something happened and it happens. What did that? It just depends. I mean, it could be the word of wisdom in operation. It could be a number of things. Can you describe the difference between a psalmist and a singer? If you can sing, I guess you are a singer, but it doesn't necessarily mean that you have influence with God, command over environments, or you have authority over the realm of lyricism by heaven. And it doesn't mean that you can interpret and translate the mood of heaven into a room and provoke God to move at the sound of your song. Why do ghosts stay on the earth? They don't. What are your thoughts on the church's role in fighting for social justice? I think that the kingdom's objective, it has a social justice component. And I think most people would agree. I just think that we are underprepared for our role in the affairs of cities. So it ends up being an issue of whether or not we are academically and financially prepared to handle the wars that are around us. How do you know if a witch or a warlock is after you? I would have to know what you mean by that. Is being clairvoyant bad? Yeah, it's witchcraft. You shouldn't be talking to dead people. How do you know if you're an intercessor? Well, there's a lot of ways I have a teaching on it. Help, I think I'm an intercessor, where I list several features of a person's life that may have a call to intercession. The best way to deal with unforgiveness. Now we're talking. Listen, let me tell you something. You are looking at a man who, because of the way God built my heart to hold things so deeply, whenever you are a deep lover a deep feeler, or if God has given you a mandate that mandates you being able to house deep things in your heart, you are a candidate to probably be affected by the spirit of unforgiveness. And if you have a tendency to have unforgiveness, you're going to allow that to grow into bitterness. I'm going to tell you how God broke the power of unforgiveness on me. I went through a back-to-back series of betrayals in my ministry, and in all of them were marked by grievous accusations and grievous, none of them were sexual in nature, I just want to put that out there, but grievous things were said about me and my character to other people, and some of them became very strong, and they were from people at the time that I loved and were invested in financially, relationally, and they betrayed me for an opportunity with an older Caucasian gentleman. And so during that time and when that stuff happened, it happened over the span of maybe a year, and it grew into a strong spirit of unforgiveness. And so what the Lord told me one day was that he was disgusted by my worship because of the level of unforgiveness that had grown in my heart. And I could feel the Lord pulling me into forgiveness, but I resisted because I felt like me forgiving was doing a favor for the people that had wronged me, or I felt that me forgiving was bringing justice somehow to their dealings and their doings with me. So I didn't respond, and the Holy Ghost would convict me, move into forgiveness, and I just would not do it. And the way I didn't do it is because I thought that it was unfair. My forgiveness was God agreeing with their action, right? And so one day the Lord told me in prayer that no matter what happened, that nothing nobody did should have the right to make me look like his adversary. And as long as I looked like his adversary, I could not get help from him. So I had to be delivered. So I remember the Lord giving me an assignment, and he told me the way you're going to break this is that you're going to become a personal intercessor for these gentlemen that have done these things to you and done these things and said these things against you. Now I chose, because I'm Mr. Justice, right is right, wrong is wrong, black is black, white is white. I'm like, God, I mean, be an intercessor. What do you mean? Why? They have people, you know, they're throwing my name through the mud. These people are preaching at me. And, you know, this older Caucasian dude is running around here defaming me, cursing me. And he got his little proselytes, you know, following him and all of this crap. Why do I have to be an intercessor? And the Lord told me, obey me. And so for a period of 21 days, I began to pray for these gentlemen every day. I never let them know. I had no contact with them. I was not in a relationship with them. They were in a whole other part of the country. And I began to pray. And I began to pray. And when I started praying, I would be like, Lord, bless them, heal them, deliver them, do something with them in Jesus' name. And I didn't feel like I was getting any better. I still had resentment in my heart, because if somebody mentioned their names, if I saw them in another environment, I would still cringe at the sight of them. So I knew that unforgiveness was still there. Hey, Augie, miss you, man. And so one day God told me, I want you to pray, and I want you to make sure that my highest good for them comes to pass. And so one day I begin to pray, and I pray like they were, pray for them like I was praying for somebody I really loved. And as I begin to intercede for the things God showed me he wanted to do in their future, something broke in me. It's going to be difficult to remain in unforgiveness when you pray into the mind of God. This is why in Matthew 5, Jesus is so wise by telling us to pray for them that despitefully use you, and pray for them that do wrong against you, because he knows when you take on the posture of intercession for an enemy, you can't feel the same way about them. So God will deal with them in their wickedness, and he will deal with them in what they've done, and he will deal with their injustice. But when you pray for them, God breaks the authority of unforgiveness in your life, and that will give you greater access to grace and ability from him. But he can never give you grace and ability if you look like Satan, and in unforgiveness, that's exactly what you look like. What should you do if you think a prophetess is dabbling in witchcraft? Talk to her about it. Is it normal? Oh, whoa, it's going really fast. I'm sorry. This is going really fast. As a leader in ministry, how do you balance ministry and do what you're compassionate about outside of ministry? Well, I would say, I mean, there's a number of things. Balance is always a subject that people in ministry need to talk about. And I'm going to just be very honest with you, depending upon the level of influence or responsibility you have, I don't really know that there is such a thing. It just, after a while, it just starts to feel like organized chaos where you've got to make time for all of it. And but a part of remaining sober and remaining sane and remaining safe is that you've got to have friends. You got to have quiet time. You must learn the art of retreat. You must be invested in vacation. And you got to have lots of sex with your spouse. That's the key to balance. Next. This is going really far. How do you deal with negative seeds being sown in your childhood? I'm sorry, I couldn't catch that one. Everybody don't have a spouse. Well, apply the other ones. How do you grow? Is it okay to refuse a title and just be a servant? Certainly. I mean, if that's what God has called you to do, being a servant in service is necessary for every applicable of the kingdom. I don't know that titles make you effective, but I would say that for some people's assignments, it might be needful. I don't know that I'm going to say that it's even everybody or even most of us, so I'm not exactly certain about that. What are your thoughts about people being in a ministry for 20 plus years? If the ministry is alive and flourishing and progressive, way to go. Yeah, I don't know that it's bad. Try Blab. You can interact with viewers. Is that an app or something? I'm not sure. How do you know when you and your spouse, when your spouse has found you? He will tell you. How do you not let your past fears hinder your new interests or passions? Great question. How do I prevent fear from my past to prevent me from moving into something that I want to do in the future? Fear is a powerful inducement that Satan likes to use and Satan likes to hit. Let me tell you this. Satan will attack in your confidence the parts of you he is most afraid of. And there is only one way to deal with fear, and it's to do the thing you're afraid of. Fear has torment, the Bible says. And because fear has torment, if you are passive about being delivered, fear is a demon that I hate with my guts. I hate the devil. The spirit of fear is one of the worst because it's like a paralysis agent. It keeps people out of potential. It keeps people out of their capacity. It keeps people out of their focus. It keeps people out of their future. So the only way that you get out of fear is to do the thing you are afraid of. And even if you've got to do it afraid, do it. Once you do it, glory. I just felt the anointing come on me. The hold of fear will let you go, and you'll find that the thing that you were afraid of was probably stretched out and exaggerated by hell to keep you intimidated by it. All right. How do you cover children so they are not affected by the parents' lack of deliverance? What do you mean by that? Let me know. Hey, Jacob, how do you break the news? I'm sorry. Does the church have a place ready for Elijah? Elijah who? He dead. I don't know what you mean by that. Good book for an intercessor. Possessing the Gates of the Enemy by Cindy Jacobs, Effective Fervent Prayer by Mary Alice Islip, and The Watchman by Dr. Joe Eboji, Eboji. How do you maintain when you're assigned to a church where there's no green gas? Well, I would be sure that I'm certain that I'm assigned there. I am finding that what a lot of people call assignments is a sense of obligation because of what they feel about the status or the state of that church. I am not convinced that God would assign a person to a place that's incapable of feeding them. I believe that if God has you in a place and if God has sent you to a place, I believe that there is going to be a mutually beneficial a relationship that's going to keep you able to be healthy in your assignment. Think about it. Is it the nature of God to send you on an assignment somewhere that's incapable of strengthening you for the quality of that assignment? If you're on an assignment to a house that's not capable of strengthening you, then it means you got to be strengthened elsewhere to come back and deplete that strength in a house that, based upon the no green grass principle, don't even have the capacity to make your impart and your investment useful. So the real truth is you may just feel guilty about the state of the house and have not developed the heart enough to get out of there. So you may want, and I'm not saying this is God, I'm just saying that I have known people that have the superhero syndrome that think that they're going to come with a prophetic cape on it and switch the direction of the Titanic in 24 hours, and it's not going to happen, guys. One of the things that you've got to realize is the culture of the church is probably more powerful than the anointing that's in you. There was only one time in the Bible where the Bible says Jesus could not do no uncertain miracles, and it was because of the culture of people. Now, Jesus was Mr. Miracle Worker. He moved. He was the Son of God incarnate. There was no reason why he shouldn't have been able to do miracles, but a person's culture had the ability to choke the anointing. So you may be anointed, but that culture may be drowning you out. So you need to get in an assignment that's conducive for what God put in you, because God's not going to send you into an environment that's going to kill you while you're trying to help them. Why do some people vomit while being delivered? Because demons move through airways. As a leader, where are you spiritually fed? My pastors, my mentors, my counselors. You've got to be spiritually fed by people you deliberately subject yourself to if you are a leader and a pastor. What about being able to not let offense settle in you? Good question, God's woman for life. How do I become unoffendable? That is one of my life's objectives as a leader, as a controversial leader, as a prophetic leader, all that I am. One of my life's goal is to be unoffendable. And there is a way where you can practice a certain level of things to make it impossible to offend you. Now, you may say, well, I'm a human. Jesus said offenses must come, and that's true, but it is possible to have offenses come and not become offended. Jesus said, blessed is he who is not offended because of me. So you're going to have offensive things happen, but there is a way to not allow that offense to dictate your reaction or your response or to cultivate your personality. That's what being offended is. You allow an offensive scenario to dictate your reaction and your response. And so because of that, you've got to build yourself and reinforce your soul where you do not harbor offense based upon somebody's action. What that is, you know, you take your cue from another person's action, and what it really is a form of control. And what it means is that you have allowed a person's immaturity, insult, or their action to determine what your response would be. And what you need to learn, step number one in becoming unoffendable, is refuse to allow people the control over your eternal peace and your eternal security. You have got to take your heart, your soul, your mind, your will, your emotions out of the hand of other people's actions and align it with the word of God. And when you compare your good to another person's evil, it may give you the right to be offended. But when you compare, you know, yourself to the standards of the word of God, you're going to find that you don't even have a right to really maintain offended. So I have made it my life's goal to be impossible to offend me. I'm growing into it. I've gotten pretty good. I would say I'm 90% there. It's very difficult to offend me. And because of that, I have earned, I want you to hear this, a level of focus that is rare to come by in what I do. So don't waste time being offended and learn how to become unoffendable by being quick to forgive, being quick to converse. Now, a lot of times when people get offended is because of miscommunication and misunderstanding. What you do is, if you've had something that offends you take place, you be quick to talk about it. Most offenses happen because you don't talk about things quick enough. And when you don't talk about things quick enough, you allow for cases to be built in your mind that seem to confirm your suspicions to begin with. So be quick to talk about something when it's offended you, and don't let days pass, because by the time days have passed, this thing has been growing and swelling in you, and maybe this person is doing things that is confirming your feelings about it. So just talk about it quick. Just refuse to be offended. Especially if you think you're going to be really great and you have major influence, you've got to make up in your mind to never be offended. I'm trying to catch some of these questions as they come up. How do you discover your purpose? Is the cost of living in Chicago expensive? It is. Well, you discover your purpose. The revelation of purpose is progressive. God starts to give you themes of your life very early on after deliverance, but then you're going to find out that there are certain things about your purpose that he discloses based upon your ability to steward it effectively. And so he'll start to give you assignments first before he reveals your purpose. And once you are obedient to those consistent assignments, you're going to notice the theme of those assignments, the strengths that you have in them, and then your purpose will become like a narrative that God has expressed to you, and it'll be more clear. Come on, next. Got married unsaved. I'm walking with God now. He doesn't believe. What now? 18 years married. Good question. Paul gives you several ways to win the heart of an unsaved spouse and convert them by right behavior. I would say that you're as a saved spouse with an unsaved spouse after 18 years, I think that if you cannot win that man by right behavior, then there's something else interfering with his persuasion of the Lord. You need to minister to that man by kindness, by meekness, and by displaying the God that won your heart to him in a way that he could perceive it. And you'll start to find that if he notices change in you, it may draw him closer to the Savior. The Bible says the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife. And so because of that, you got to learn the law of your ministry and how it wins him to the Lord. Living in a different state, maybe thinking and moving to join your church. Oh, welcome. There's room for you at the well. How do you tell a four-year-old no and they accept it? I can't. I'm in college, but I can't find a church that helps develop my gifts. Well, I'm certain there's a community somewhere. I would caution you to not look for the perfect church and not look for a church that's going to be strong in everything, but look for a church that's capable of feeding you based upon what God is doing in you in this season. Don't go into looking for a church while you're in your college years that's going to be everything you needed to be. I would say you need to be in a place where there is powerful worship. I would say that you need to be in a place where there is an uncompromised present truth word being preach, and I would say that you need to be in a place where there is the access to community. You're going to need relationships to form. They don't have to be massive revival heads or see miracles every week, but I would say look for the health of that congregation, and you'll begin to develop your gifts on the way there. Keys symbolize access, authority, opportunities, and favor. Can you lead a church as a prophet? Certainly. Who would win one-on-one, Undertaker or The Rock? Noah wants to know. The problem with that question is that I'm a diehard Undertaker head, so I'm never going to say that The Rock would beat The Undertaker because it's a violation. But nothing here like Scope Temple or Anwa. If you tell me what state you're in, I'll let you know if I could recommend it. Contact Tara Caruff for all your relocation needs to move. I'll go into an Anwa. True story. Tara Caruff or Marilynette Barney may be able to handle your relocating east to Chicago. Tara Caruff is awesome, so you certainly may need to find her. How do you show a person love without entertaining their simple action? Well, there's a way to love a person and not agree with their behavior. I would say you need to begin to value them and make time for them and not always emphasize their destruction, but refuse to agree with it. That's very important. After casting out demons, what needs to be done in place? Good question. The aftercare for the casting out of devils is going to be follow-up and discipleship. Whenever a person has had extensive deliverance over a season, they really do need to have a notch up moved in their discipleship. My saying is this, deliverance without discipleship is malpractice. There's a lot of people who come up to altar calls every week. They got all kinds of surgeries that they have on them in the spirit, but they don't have aftercare or follow-up. I would say that person needs their community tightened up, but that person also needs to change their set of habits that they do. So that's very important. Can you pastor or counsel me in Colorado? Probably not. We are moving this summer. Who do we need to talk to? If you want an apartment, I would say Tara Caruff. R-U-F-F. Can you rebuke storms? You sure can. What if the unsaved spouse mocks your worship? Well, the God that operates and lives in you is more powerful than the God that operates in them. I would say don't be so sensitive about it. And I would say begin to intercede that God softens their heart and gives you supernatural insight into what's going on. Have you yet recognized the spiritual gifts of your natural children? for the most part, I know what's operating in them, but and they show signs of it and tattletale signs. When my kids pray, I can hear their spiritual gifts operating based upon the things that they think to pray about soon. So, I would say to that they're going to tell on themselves, but again, outlet and opportunity is most important because it'll give you language for what operates in them. So I do know that, that some of them have the gifts that they have, and it is possible to know. Oh, a good book for psalmists, Worship, The Pattern of Things in Heaven by Bishop Joseph Garlington. Talk about jealousy and ministry relationships. That is a great question. Listen, 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 listen. Jealousy is a major issue in the body of Christ with regard to ministry and ministry relationships, and it's all going to stem from unconfronted insecurity. The root of jealousy is insecurity and low self-esteem. What we are finding out as we try to build relationships in ministry is that people run into ministry before they become secure as people. They come and they realize they are anointed, they realize they have a talent, but the development and the discipline that they need in their heart is not there, and so they cannot handle a person being gifted or a person excelling or a person having something that they don't have now or they don't have yet. And so because of that, the real question is, how do we handle insecurity? Because before something grows into jealousy, it starts as rejection or insecurity. And it's a very dangerous snare to have when you have authority over people. And ministry, although it is service, it's going to end up relating to your influence or authority over people. And insecurity always behaves ugly when it has authority. Now, most of us hide insecurity by our abilities in the microphone and our ability to conceal our fractures with the anointing, because under the anointing, none of that stuff shows up. It's your conversations will reveal it, your habits will reveal it, your tendencies, your views will reveal it. I would say be very wise, because I don't know that you could be honest friends with somebody who is jealous than you. I don't know that you could be honest friends with somebody who desires to be you. I don't know that you could be honest friends. I mean, I have gotten so much of this over the years that I've really become immune to it, and it doesn't affect my heart. I know that it comes with the territory, but I mean, it's a very interesting thing. You know, if I were a guy who were 600 pounds and frankly unattractive, or if I had 12 members, I wouldn't have half of the issues that I have. But the real truth is, we have not had leaders and relationships in our lives that can help us to handle our insecurities the right way so that it does not grow into jealousy. So you've got to be very careful with that, because it will end up becoming as cruel as the grave. Jealousy is a cruel demon. And when it's happening in preachers, it could go a lot of different ways and clicks and circuits. So I have a couple of preacher friends, but the majority of my friends are not preachers. They are other people. Now, luckily, shameless plug, in the Gate Network, we're working on building a massive, extreme, over-the-top culture of honor that ends up not allowing for the demon of jealousy to last long, because we choke it out by dealing with it one-on-one. And when we do deal with it one-on-one and confront it held on, we go into Jesus, fix my life, and then it ends up being repented, so we do it good. Can you recommend a church in upstate New York? Upstate New York, Glory House International, Pastor Melvin Cross. What does the Bible say about integrity? Well, the Bible talks about the currency of your name and your reputability, that it is very important that you learn how to use the currency of your reputation and your rapport. So it means that you need to be known for certain things, and there needs to also be a level of things around you that you're not known for, things that are far from you. So it's very important that you protect your integrity. And by building integrity, you need to be consistent with certain things. You need to abhor other things. You need to make it known what you stand on certain issues. And you also not need to allow your good to be evil spoken of. That's very important that you realize. Okay, who's next? I'm going to give you 10 more minutes. How do you keep kids safe? Still need deliverance from anger and wrath. I don't understand what you mean. Church recommendation in LA, I'm going to recommend Kingdom Culture Worship Center, Apostle Sherman Dumas. A church in Denver, Colorado. Bishop Kevin Foreman is in Colorado. I would recommend him. Yes, sir. We're building a culture of honor in the gate. Why is emotional intelligence so low in ministry leadership? Because the way we train leaders. I think that's probably one of the best questions somebody asked me. The subject of emotional intelligence is something that we have not invested in because we are distracted by people's ability. And some here over the last 50 or 60 years, people's ability trumped their maturity. And because we platform people based upon their ability and nobody ever investigates what they can handle, how they recover, what they're like when the lights are off, then we end up with ministry messes because of the way we train preachers or the lack of training, period. A church in Philadelphia. I don't think I have one. What do you think folks should do about church hurt? Same thing they do about family hurt, people hurt, boss hurt, work hurt. I think they should get over it, move on, confront it, and grow, because I don't believe that there is a such thing as church hurt. I think that there is a such thing as people hurt, and people who go to the church bring their issues, and it ends up hurting each other. People have thoughts on women pastors. Absolutely. I believe that women can be pastors. The Bible says in Romans chapter 16 that there was a woman who was an apostle. Her name is Junia. I believe it's Romans 16:7. And the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapters 12 through 20, chapters 12 and 28, that apostles are first in the church. And so by intelligent scriptural interpretation, if a woman can occupy the office of the apostle, which outranks the office of the pastor, then certainly she can fulfill the role of a pastor, which is a subsequent office to the role of the apostle. A church in Dallas, The Way Church in Dallas, Pastor Tavares Gardner. Go there now. Church in Manhattan, I don't have one. How do you handle leaders who teach erroneous doctrine to their members? It depends on what the doctrine is and what your relationship is to them. I would say if it is a heresy, then it needs to be called a heresy. If you cannot convince that leader that their truth is not a truth, then I would say that you just caution people to move away from it, because the thing about heresy is that it grows into deception, and you don't want that to be the case. A deliverance training resource for leaders. Ooh, there's a lot of them out there. I would say Derek Prince, my father in the Lord, the man that introduced me to the apostolic ministry, Apostle John Eckhart, has millions of stuff available. There's a lot of stuff out there. How do you pick churches to be a part of the Gate Network? I personally do not. We have a presbytery of elders that govern our decision-making with the churches that we allow in our fellowship. And there is a process and an interviewing process that we go through to make sure that they are compatible with our DNA and that we are actually the ones to serve them effectively. Should you stay at a church just because your parents are the pastors? Nope, not at all. How do you nurture the intercessor within? By prayer projects, by discipline in your days, and by regular recording and research on things that you need to pray about. What are your thoughts on demonic attacks? Be more specific and I'll answer that. Do you have seasons of isolation? No. When I got saved, I became a part of the body. But I do have moments of stillness where I'm with myself to and before the Lord, and he's dealing with me. But God has not called anybody to isolation. I don't have a question. Oh, thank you so much. Not a problem. Does theophostic deliverance counseling work? Be more specific. Church of Florida or Georgia. I have heard great things about several churches in Georgia. If you're in the Atlanta area, I would recommend Apostle Brian Meadows of the Embassy Church. I would also recommend Worship with Wonders Church, Pastor Miles Rutherford. You got Life Center, Apostle Buddy and Mary Crum. It just depends on what your flavor and what your style is in the Georgia area. There's quite a few of them there. What if you're no longer being fed at your church? Go somewhere where you can be fed. Dr. Sharona is a great pastor. I love Bishop Mark Sharona. The Way Fellowship Church in Dallas. Yeah, that's a church in Dallas that you can go to. I don't have a church in San Diego. Can you be assigned to your spouse? I don't know what if you have a spouse, you are assigned to him. Married and equally yoked. What do you mean? Any churches in Phoenix, Arizona, I would recommend Pastor LeBryant Friend, who is in Tucson, Arizona, of the Mount Calvary Baptist Church. Do you have to support your father monetarily to honor him? I'm not going to say that you have to. I think that it's a good expression, because the Bible says where your treasure is, there's your heart is there as well. So sometimes it could be a representation of honor. Other times it could be a bribe. I just need Chicago and Georgia to be closer together. Certainly. How do you deal with those you lead and refuse to grow? You quarantine them and you don't give them responsibility that's beyond what they believe to be challenged in. Huntsville, Alabama, I would say All Nations Church, Pastor Adrian Davis in Huntsville. Can you divorce if you are unequally yoked? The Bible says, if the unbelieving depart, let him depart. You have a conversation with the pastor, let him know you've made a decision to leave and you go. How do you direct your prayers when you dream about reasons you never traveled to? I would say become a researcher and involve yourself with trying to understand what's going on in those regions, what's affecting the families, the finances, the politics, the education of that region, and begin to gather as much information as you can and start to pray into that. How have you dealt with rebellion in your church and ministry? Now we talking, bro. Rebellion. I hate the spirit of rebellion. Rebellion is behind every major criminal activity in the world. That demon of defiance and rebellion is why we just saw what we saw in Paris. That demon of rebellion is why we see the death rate spiking. That demon of rebellion is why we have urban terrorists and thugs that call themselves trying to bring change to cities by reckless bloodshed. So I don't believe that rebellion has a size. I deal with it the moment it shows up. Now, in the Old Testament, what many people don't know is that it was actually a part of the law that you could kill a person if they were rebellious. If you had a son in your house, the Bible says you needed to get a rock and let the elders of the city kill him. That's how the Old Testament writers saw the nature of rebellion. Rebellion and lawlessness is the primary reason behind every major catastrophe in the world. So the way you deal with rebellion is that you have got to confront it and you do not allow it opportunity. In order to be effective, rebellion needs opportunity. So when I notice that rebellion is taking place, I have an immediate discussion about what's going on in them and why they are defiant. If we cannot get them to repent, we immediately remove them from influence, responsibility, and expectation, because a rebel has the power to not only be dangerous and tear things down, but they have the power to recruit. The spirit of rebellion normally is active in a person that is very, very, very alone. And so what they do to master their rebellion and to make it more effective is that they find opportunities to sow seeds of that rebellion into other people to make their attempts more potent. And so you immediately quarantine them by refusing to allow them access and opportunity to have their rebellion published on a larger scale. And ultimately, God will start to deal with that person's rebellion by making sure that they are bankrupt and not able to finance larger levels of discord and attack. I do not play with the demon of rebellion, and I'm anointed for it. I'm anointed for rebellious people, believe it or not. Then how do you identify rebellion? Is it rebellion or controlling leader? It could be either or, because I don't know that there always has to be a complete agreement depending upon what there is, but I just think there needs to be a coming together and a sharing of hearts about what the core issues are and who has Bible to support what action. How to mend relationships with an unsaved or bitter parent? That is a powerful, powerful, powerful question. When you are trying to mend a broken relationship with an unsaved or a bitter parent, what you've got to do is resolve that people love the way they know how. It would be very important for you to, number one, resolve that you should not allow yourself the license to behave as they do if you're filled with the Holy Ghost, because the one that governs your code of ethics and your personality is different from the one that codes them. And so the two of you live by two different moral and relationship compasses. And so I would say that you accept where they are, understand where they are, and not try to push them in a direction that they are uncomfortable with. But you may have to resolve to accept apologies you may not get, but put yourself in a position where you can help them to see what they are missing out on in your particular relationship. But don't force it. When people want relationships with parents or other family members, when it's gone wrong by bitterness or other things like that, they become so impassioned about restoration that they try to manufacture it and make it happen. I would just say allow for your character to be open, and allow for your heart to be open, and allow for yourself to remain consistent in your love walk irrespective of what they do, and refuse to allow yourself to become offended. And then ultimately you may see some progress. Great question, by the way. Your thoughts on World Changer Summit 2015, the greatest one yet. It was the greatest one yet. I believe it opened up some things that's going to manifest in this season. If the Sabbath is on a Saturday, why do we church on a Sunday? I'm going to be very honest with you. I don't think Jesus cares what day we have church. And I believe that you people that focus on that are bound with a religious demon. Your thoughts on excommunication from the church. Well, there are biblical parameters and biblical protocols for how and when and why somebody should be evicted from a church. I believe that some people see it as extreme, but Paul gives us a lot of insight about when somebody should be dismissed from a church. I would say read the books of 1st and 2nd Corinthians, and you'll go through the biblical precedents or reasons that substantiate somebody being dismissed from the local church when they have become a problem that has gotten in the way of the corporate and the overall objective of the kingdom in and through that church. Should you be loyal to a spiritual father whose ministry is failing and you know why? It depends on why. What book are you currently reading? It's a book called The Pendulum, and I forget the author, believe it or not, right now, but it's a book called The Pendulum. It's a book on communications in that day. How to choose the right degree. Good, 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 good. Are all women created to be wives? No, ma'am. I know that's a harsh word. I would say study something that you know you can last, and don't study something or enroll in a degree program just because you like it. Study something that is not just lucrative, but study something that you can see yourself excelling in and being passionate about consistently. I'm missing this. What is bad leadership? That's a very, 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 very broad question. What about prophets who call themselves bishops? I mean, I don't, it doesn't matter. I mean, the Bible doesn't say that a prophet can't call himself bishop, and the Bible doesn't say that a bishop can't call himself a prophet. I don't think it really matters. There are not spiritual laws and violations for calling yourself a bishop if you are a prophet. I think there are way more bishops that are not really bishoping or have no real clue what the Bible says about being a bishop than there are prophets who are being bishops. Thoughts on Christian alcoholics? Find a deliverance ministry immediately and bind the devil and cast him out. How to be more confident in your call? I would say the more you know about it. You know, generally speaking, confidence comes from security in what you know. I would say become very well versed in the tenets of your particular call and mandate, and it'll produce confidence in you in addition to the presence of God, and it's going to help you. Church in or near Detroit. The greatest thing next to Detroit I know is Revolution Christian Ministries with my friend Dr. Jamone Glenn, but he's in Grand Rapids, so I don't know how close that is to Detroit or where it's going to do. Church in Dallas. Are you asking for a church in Dallas? I told you The Way Church, that's the name of it, Pastor Tavares Garner. It's in Dallas. How do you break the news that Scope Temple does not take the place of a local assembly? I let these people know that this is not a local church. This is a cyber church. And yeah, that's how it is. Can a prophet manipulate you into joining another church, especially when you're not looking? I suppose so. I suppose so. Is there something I need to or should be doing to protect a great mantle on a child or young prophet? Yes, discipline him in the scriptures. The greatest thing you could do is discipline him in the scriptures. If a person has a call to be a prophet, but they don't have a foundation in the scriptures, they are going to behave as a diviner. Point blank, period. Bible is prophets. I pay no attention to. Matter of fact, probably 50% of the time somebody tell me they prophet or prophetess, I ignore them because very few times is it actually even real. Outlets for a prophetic child. Journaling. Journaling. How much do you as a father invest in the soul of integrity of your sons and daughters? Oh, very much so. I mean, we're going to talk about the soul. Any of them will tell you, we're going to talk about the soul, the fears, desires, temptations, fantasies, wants, passions, motives, all of the stuff that's going on in the soul. I have very candid, very brutal, very honest discussions about, and I just ask the hard questions, but I do because to me, that is the foundation of their entire destiny, is the health of their soul, and I make sure that we ask the right questions to help them trace and track the conversations that are going on in their soul, whether they realize that it's there or not. Explain the true role of an armor bearer, to be an intercessor and a support of the vision and the role and the mantle of the leader that they're serving. Will Scope Temple get a building? Probably not. Do you think Liberty University is a good school? I absolutely do. I am an alum of Liberty University and it's a great school. Any biblical foundation for inherited pastoring, father and son? Nope, not at all. I'm not going to say that it's not possible. I'm just going to say that most people do it because they see ministry as the family business and they feel more secure with leaving the organizations that they build in their family. Not totally biblical. In fact, many times I have seen and I have discerned prophetically where the successor of a ministry is not somebody with the same last name. It's just one of the things that church people do, especially when they don't have prophetic outlets and insight to those that carry the real oil to carry an organization into the future. All right, it's 10:07. I'm getting up out of here. I love you guys so much. I gave y'all more time than what I should. I find that I probably need to do more Q&As to engage with my awesome Scope Temple audience. I would like to join the network of prophets at your church. Probably not. We don't have a network of prophets, and the prophets that we do have in our church are a member of our local church, and we have an accountability strata for them, and that's how they get their training and their development. All right, I love you guys. I think that you are awesome. I will find time to do another Q&A. Ricky Watson, you're so important to me, sir. Emery Diggs, thank you for your prayers. You guys are the bomb diggity. Thank you for spending time with me, and I will find out what I'm talking about tomorrow morning. And I'll see y'all then. All right. Love you too, Augie. All right. Peace out. Bye-bye.